Be a good day to do the COVID seating. Everybody sit 6 feet apart, so it looks like a big crowd. Well, good evening. It's good to have you guys here tonight. I'm glad to actually see anybody. It's between everybody being sick and holidays and everything else. It's just it's good to be together with y'all. A couple quick announcements. Tomorrow night we're going to have Thanksgiving dinner together at 5 o'clock, and that's going to be at our house instead of church because a few people kind of canceled out, make it easier that way. So just bring a side dish and a dessert, and we'll have a great time together. And then Saturday, the 26th, we're going to decorate the church for Christmas. And so if anybody wants to help out do that, we're going to show up here at 9 o'clock and work for a few hours and put up the garland and all the stuff, and that'll be a lot of fun. And then looking ahead, December 9th, which is a Friday evening, we're going to have the church Christmas dinner here at the church building at 6 o'clock. And we invited the Teen Challenge guys to come have dinner with us. They're excited about that. And so I'm going to ask everybody to make sure you bring plenty of food because they're really good at putting it away. And church will get some extra food as well. But church will provide for Christmas a ham or two and a turkey, and maybe we'll get a couple of pies. But anyway, everybody else bring all the side stuff, and it'll be great. And then December 15th, which is a Thursday evening, the women are going to have their Christmas cookie exchange and fellowship. It's no longer the stocking exchange. It's just the cookie exchange. And so bring 2 dozen cookies that you can exchange with everybody else there. It starts at 5:30, and that's at the Fuller home. And so if you have questions about that, get a hold of us, and we'll get you squared away. But with that, Father God, thank you for bringing us here. Thank you for the opportunity to worship you. And we ask that you would guide us, Lord. Help us to worship you in spirit and in truth. In Jesus' name. Amen. If you guys are able, let's stand together and worship.
Worship Christ the Lord. Worship Even faints for you. here my heart is satisfied. Within your presence I sing beneath the shadow of your wings. Better is one day in your courts. Better is one day in your house. Better is one day in your courts. That's where. Better is one day in your courts. Better is one day in your house. Better is one day in your courts. Thousands of square, thousands of square.
Gracious Father, we thank you for the privilege of getting to be in your house tonight. We thank you, Lord, for the opportunity, Lord, to sing praise and to worship you and to sit at your feet and hear your voice. And we ask, Lord, that you be glorified in this place. Speak to us tonight, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Well, hey, why don't you wave at each other across the room, that kind of stuff. Hey, Jim. All righty. Well, hey, tonight we're going to be in Jeremiah chapter 27 as we continue in our trek through the book and through the Bible. In Jeremiah 27, and we'll read the chapter together like we usually do. Then we'll go back and we'll hit it verse by verse and study it through. So once you get your Bibles open, if you're able, would you stand with me in reverence for God's word as we read it together? I'm going to read it a little different on the first verse, so don't balk at it, but I'll explain it after we get going. But Jeremiah 27, verse 1. In the beginning of the reign of Zedekiah, the son of Josiah, king of Judah, this word came to Jeremiah from the Lord, saying, Thus says the Lord to me, Make for yourselves bonds and yokes, and put them on your neck, and send them to the king of Edom, the king of Moab, the king of the Ammonites, the king of Tyre, and the king of Sidon, by the hand of the messengers who come to Jerusalem to Zedekiah, king of Judah, and command them to say to their masters, Thus says the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, Thus you shall say to your masters, I've made the earth, the man and the beast that are on the ground, by my great power and by my outstretched arm, and have given it to whom it seemed proper to me. And now I've given all these lands into the hand of Nebuchadnezzar, the king of Babylon, my servant. And the beast of the field I have also given to him to serve him. So all nations shall serve him and his son and his son's son until the time until the time of his land comes, and then many nations and great kings shall make him serve them. And it shall be that the nation and kingdom which will not serve Nebuchadnezzar, the king of Babylon, and which will not put its neck under the yoke of the king of Babylon, that nation I will punish, says the Lord, with the sword, the famine, and the pestilence until I've consumed them by his hand. Therefore, do not listen to your prophets, your diviners, your dreamers, your soothsayers, or your sorcerers, who speak to you, saying, You shall not serve the king of Babylon. For they prophesy a lie to you, to remove you far from your land, and I will drive you out, and you will perish. But the nations that bring their necks under the yoke of the king of Babylon and serve him, I will let them remain in their own land, says the Lord, and they shall till it and dwell in it. I also spoke to Zedekiah, king of Judah, according to all these words, saying, Bring your necks under the yoke of the king of Babylon, and serve him and his people, and live. Why will you die, you and your people, by the sword, by the famine, and by the pestilence, as the Lord has spoken against the nation that will not serve the king of Babylon? Therefore, do not listen to the words of the prophets who speak to you, saying, You shall not serve the king of Babylon, for they prophesy a lie to you. For I have not sent them, says the Lord, yet they prophesy a lie in my name, that I may drive you out, and that you may perish, you and the prophets who prophesy to you. Also I spoke to the priests and to all this people, saying, Thus says the Lord, do not listen to the words of your prophets who prophesy to you, saying, Behold, the vessels of the Lord's house will now shortly be brought back from Babylon, for they prophesy a lie to you. Do not listen to them. Serve the king of Babylon and live. Why should this city be laid waste? But if they are prophets, and if the word of the Lord is with them, Let them now make intercession to the Lord of hosts, that the vessels which are left in the house of the Lord, in the house of the king of Judah, and at Jerusalem, do not go to Babylon. For thus says the Lord God, the Lord of hosts, concerning the pillars, concerning the sea, concerning the carts, and concerning the remainder of the vessels that remain in this city, which Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, did not take when he carried away captive Jeconiah, the son of Jehoiakim, king of Judah, from Jerusalem to Babylon, and all the nobles of Judah and Jerusalem. Yes, thus says the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, concerning the vessels that remain in the house of the Lord and in the house of the king of Judah and of Jerusalem. They shall be carried to Babylon, yet they shall be until and there they shall be until the day that I visit them, says the Lord. Then I will bring them up and restore them to this place. Gracious Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you, Lord, for the warning of it. We thank you for the encouragement of it. We thank you, Lord, mostly for the truth of it. It's all true. And Lord, help us just to understand it better and to hear your voice in the midst of it, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. Well, welcome you guys. You can be seated. Now, it says in the very first verse, and I changed it in my Bible to reflect what I think is the actuality of it, but my Bible is printed, it's a New King James Bible, and it says, in the beginning of the reign of Jehoiakim, the son of Josiah, king of Judah, this word came to Jeremiah from the Lord, saying. And I changed it in my Bible to read in the beginning of the reign of Zedekiah. Now, this is one of those rare instances in the Bible where there appears to be a copyist error. Now, it's not an error in the original manuscripts. That was, right on. But as they made copies of copies of copies, there are a couple of known instances in the Bible where it's likely to be a copyist error. Because in the previous chapter, it starts off the same way, and I was always kind of wondering, like, why did it start off with the exact same sentence? And then it switches in verse 3, talking about when he came to Zedekiah. And then again in verse 12, when he came to Zedekiah. And so it would appear to be a copyist error, along with the fact of other verses that talk about the actions that Zedekiah did that would be, in a certain sense, attributed to Jehoiakim. And so I had to kind of dig around and do some research. But I believe it is to Zedekiah. Now, the reason is because otherwise, God tells Jeremiah to make these yokes, and he's going to carry them around for 11 years until they can deliver them to the people he says to. Or is it like it says there in verse 3 and again in verse 12, assuming that he's talking to Zedekiah as opposed to Jehoiakim? And so I think he's talking to Jehoiakim. And then I'll give you a couple. I'm sorry, he's talking to Zedekiah, not Jehoiakim. And so, but just to give you the history a little bit, Zedekiah is one of the sons, or actually grandsons, of King Josiah, who died in battle against the Egyptians under Pharaoh Necho, against the Egyptians. And they came to Jerusalem after that and took Jehoahaz, Josiah's heir, and at that time the present king of Judah. He only reigned for 3 months. The Egyptians took him captive, took him back to Egypt where he died. And then Pharaoh Necho appointed Jehoahaz's older brother Eliakim to be king and renamed him Jehoiakim, who would then reign for 11 years until being taken captive by Nebuchadnezzar back to Babylon. That was in 605 BC. And there he died a poor man's death, and as it says in Scripture, received the burial of a donkey. Which is not a very good thing. And then Eliakim was appointed by Nebuchadnezzar to be the king at that point, and he was renamed Zedekiah by Nebuchadnezzar. And so he's known mostly as, you see him as Eliakim in a couple of places, but mostly he's known in scriptures as Zedekiah, to whom I believe this portion of the passage is addressed. Now, it's an interesting thing because Zedekiah swore an oath by the true and living God to King Nebuchadnezzar that he would submit to the king of Babylon, and that he would be a vassal king or whatever. He would pay tribute to Nebuchadnezzar. But somewhere about like 3 or 4 years into it, he rebels against King Nebuchadnezzar, breaks his word, and tries to join with the confederation of other, you know, countries around them, including Egypt, to fight against the Babylonians. The thing is, God holds him accountable. Say, you swore in my name that you would do this. You know, you would submit. And then he rebels, breaking his oath. And it's interesting because later on, Nebuchadnezzar, when he brings Zedekiah in front of him, just, you know, as he kills his sons and gouges out his eyes, all that kind of stuff, he brings up the fact, hey, you swore an oath. You gave me your word. We shook hands and you broke it. And I think that would have been better off if he said, no, I can't do that. Just kill me, you know, or no, I can't do that. Take me prisoner. Do whatever you're going to do, but not to swear an oath by God and then not keep it. And that's part of why it goes down the way it does. But in 2 Chronicles chapter 36, verse 13, it says, and he also rebelled against King Nebuchadnezzar, who had made him swear an oath by God. But he stiffened his neck and hardened his heart against turning to the Lord God of Israel. And so he didn't just break his word to Nebuchadnezzar, he broke his word to God. It's recorded in Ezekiel. In Ezekiel chapter 17, verse 13 and 16, it says, and he took the king's offspring, this is Nebuchadnezzar, he took the king's offspring, speaking of Zedekiah, and made a covenant with him and put him under oath. He took away the mighty of the land. And then in verse 16, it says, and this is God speaking now, as I live, says the Lord God, surely in the place where the king dwells, who made him king, whose oath he despised and whose covenant he broke with him, in the midst of Babylon, he shall die. And so there's another prophecy about Zedekiah that he would be taken to Babylon, but another one says that he would never see Babylon. And so people think that these prophecies contradict each other. But what happens is, and they're spoken well ahead of time, and what happens is Zedekiah is captured. He has his eyes gouged out, and so and then he's taken to Babylon where he dies. So he went to Babylon, but he never saw it. And so it's just one of those kind of, I won't say quirky, but one of those interesting prophecies that you don't think it's going to be fulfilled, but then it's fulfilled exactly, literally, as God spoke it. And so pretty cool. So in the beginning of the reign of Zedekiah, the word of the Lord came to Jeremiah. And then in verse 2, he says, thus says the Lord, thus said the Lord to me, make for yourselves bonds and yokes, and put them on your neck. And so the Lord instructs Jeremiah to make both bonds, and I think of handcuffs or fetters or chains in some respect, and yokes. And a yoke is a sign of servitude. You know, when you put it on an oxen or a bull of some kind, you know, that's a beast of burden, if you will. And so it talks about servitude. And they're told to put these things on their necks. Now, He's describing something that's futuristic to them, but past tense to us. You know, we had a yoke of bondage that we were freed from. But these guys are going to be going into that season, if you will. But it isn't, excuse me, it is kind of interesting that many of us, through our choices in life, make for ourselves self-imposed bonds and yokes that we imprison ourselves through our choices. And whether, you know, sex, drugs, and rock and roll sounds like a party until you realize that it's actually a trap. You know, it's a cage. It's a prison. Similarly, alcohol so often leads to alcoholism. It's a slippery, deep pit. I think that religion can be the same thing at times. You know, man's rules on how to get to heaven or materialism or, you know, leads to debt. And so often that's a snare as well. There's a number of different things that we, as a culture, as a people, we've been set free by Jesus Christ, but yet we find ourselves slaves to, you know, whatever, where we needn't be. Peter tells us in 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 19, he says, while they promise them liberty, they themselves are slaves of corruption. For by whom a person is overcome, by him also he's brought into bondage. And so to me, this is a graphic picture of the future for them, because they're being told what's going to happen if they don't straighten up. And it's the past for us, hopefully, that we look behind and go, wow, Jesus, you know, freed me up. It's a warning to them and a reminder of what we've been delivered from. If you will, turn to the right in your Bible to Romans chapter 6, because Paul kind of describes our being set free, and I really enjoy that, just knowing that we have that liberty in Christ Jesus, the freedom not to sin, that we're no longer slaves to sin. So in Romans chapter 6, I'm going to pick it up at verse 4. In Romans chapter 6, verse 4, it says, "Therefore, we were buried with him through baptism into death, that just as Jesus Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in newness of life. For if we have been united together in the likeness of his death, certainly we also shall be in the likeness of his resurrection. Knowing this, that our old man was crucified with him, and that the body of sin might be done away with, that we should no longer be slaves of sin. For he who has died has been freed from sin. Now if we died with Christ, we believe that we shall also live with him, knowing that Christ, having been raised from the dead, dies no more, death no longer has dominion over him. For the death that he died to sin once for all. But the life that he lives to God. Likewise, you also reckon yourselves to be dead indeed to sin, but alive to God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Therefore, do not let sin reign in your mortal body, that you should obey it in its lusts. Do not present or yield your members as instruments of unrighteousness to sin, but present yourselves to God as being alive from the dead, and your members as instruments of righteousness to God. For sin shall not have dominion over you, for you are not under the law, but under grace. What then? Shall we sin because we are not under the law, but under grace? Certainly not. Do you not know that to whom you present yourselves slaves to obey, you are that one slave whom you obey, whether of sin leading to death or of obedience leading to righteousness. But God be thanked that though you were slaves of sin, yet you obeyed from the heart that form of doctrine which you to which you were delivered. And having been set free from sin, you became slaves of righteousness." And so, again, just the awesome fact that we've been set free and delivered from our bondage. And, you know, religion could be such a snare that confines and imprisons, but a personal faith walk with the true and living God is liberating. It frees us up. I love, you know, as Jesus said in John 8:36, "Therefore, if the Son makes you free, you shall be free indeed." And we need to just hang on to that, not to re-engage in the bondage of sin and all the other things that want to constrain us. Paul exhorts the Galatians in Galatians chapter 5, verse 1. He said, "Stand fast, therefore, in the liberty by which he has made us free, and do not be entangled again with a yoke of bondage." You know, and that can come in so many different forms, like I said, but just to be careful that we stay close to him, you know. And, you know, it's not like we have to go to church. We get to go to church. You know, it's not like we have to read our Bibles. We love to read our Bibles because we learn more about him, you know, and we draw close to him and he speaks to us. And I love that. I love it when he speaks to me, you know, and we don't have to pray. I mean, it's like me I've got to talk to my wife. Oh, no. You know, it's like it's a joy to talk to a like-minded believer and think about how much more it is when it puts a smile on God's face when we say, "Lord," you know, and we just begin to talk to him about what's going on. And then he'll talk back to us too, and so it's the joy of having that relationship. And so we've been set free from all the things that keep us from that. Now in verse 3, going back to Jeremiah chapter 27, in verse 3 it says, "And send them these yokes and these bonds, send them to the king of Edom, the king of Moab, the king of the Ammonites, the king of Tyre, and the king of Sidon, by the hand of messengers who come to Jerusalem to Zedekiah, king of Judah." And so, again, this reference to Zedekiah is why I think this is actually more or less addressed to him. But they're told, Jeremiah is told to make these bonds, these fetters. So now he's like in his garage, I guess, making up, you know, 5 or 6 sets of handcuffs and chains and yokes and stuff. And he says, take them to each of these individual kings, these 5 kings. Actually, it's 5 kings, but then later on we get to verse 12. We're going to add Zedekiah, the king of Judah, into this. So he'd be making 6 sets of each, apparently. but it's intended to be a very practical message, if you will, to these respective kings. And it's interesting, it's not said to the people like the Moabites or whoever, send it to the king of Moab and to the king of Edom, to the leaders themselves. And so in part, I believe it's because each of these kings will determine what happens to their kingdoms and their people corporately, their decision to heed the word of God or to ignore it will determine the fate of each nation. And, you know, obviously we'll read through history that they make a bad choice. But it's not random. These five kings were actually in negotiations with Zedekiah because they rebelled against the king of Babylon. God, through the prophet Jeremiah, saying, you know what? When he gets here, just submit, just relax, go with the flow, go with the program. You will stay alive that way, and your people will stay in the land. But basically, if you fight him, you're toast. And so each of these kings were working with Zedekiah to rebel against Nebuchadnezzar. And, you know, each of these kings has to make a choice. And again, how they treat the word of God from Jeremiah will determine what happens to their people. And we know that in Proverbs 14:34, it says that righteousness exalts a nation, but sin is a reproach to any people. And, you know, as I read these passages, I understand full and well that our country is in that same place. We don't have a messenger necessarily speaking directly to our president or to our senator or congressman. I wish we did. You know, a voice that stood out and said, hey, you know, thus saith the Lord, repent of your sins and turn towards him. But I think just as surely we'll be judged by that same righteous standard that God's applied to all these things at some point. But in Proverbs chapter 13, verse 13, it says, he who despises the word will be destroyed, and he who fears the commandment will be rewarded. They're being warned, they're being told ahead of time, they're each being presented with a personal message. You know, each one of them gets their own personal yoke and bond and all that stuff. But for what history teaches us, they ignore that. But interesting, the attempt anyway to convince each of these kings to submit to the authority of God through Nebuchadnezzar. We read in verse 4 and 5, it says, and command them to say to their masters, thus says the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, thus you shall say to your masters, I have made the earth, the man and the beast that are on the ground, by my great power and by my outstretched arm, and have given it to whom it seemed proper to me. And so these messengers bring these yokes, these chains and things. They present them to the respective kings. Excuse me. Anyway, and then they're each told, thus says the Lord of hosts, I made the earth. Now, why would God tell them that? Why is he taking them back in a sense to Genesis chapter 1, verse 1? Because God is declaring through the prophet, through these messengers to each of these kings, I made heaven and earth, okay? That means I'm in charge. And I set kings up, I set kings down. I determine, and I've given it to whom I wanted to give it to, and I've given it to you. But now they're facing this choice. Are they going to be obedient to the voice of God? And, if they accept that authority, then obedience will likely follow. But if they reject his authority as creator, then that disbelief will most likely lead to disobedience. And that is why we see such an incredible attack on the first book of the Bible. The book of Genesis, I believe, is the most attacked book of the 66 books of the Bible because it chips away at the foundation. You know, that's why it's pushed so hard in the public arena and public schools and everywhere else. You know, because if God didn't make it, then we're not accountable to him. But the thing is, if God did make it, then we are accountable to him. And that's exactly why you read in Genesis chapter 3, verse 1, that first question in the Bible, you know, has God indeed said? And my answer is yes, he did. And everything after that we need to follow. But these five, and I would say the six kings, are each basically the top dog in their kingdom. And they're probably not too keen on being told what to do, and or once they are at the top of that totem pole, so to speak, they're not too likely to relinquish power or control to anyone. So now they're being told, hey, he's coming. Your best option is to surrender. And, God is pointing out that he's the one that appoints kings to kingdoms. He's given it to whom it seemed proper to him. And he's my servant. It's only said a few times in the Bible, maybe three or four times, where it says that, you know, the king of Babylon is, quote unquote, his servant. And he says, and the beasts of the field I've also given to him to serve him. But when God says that Nebuchadnezzar is his servant, we know that he'll be the instrument that he uses to correct and to chasten the nation of Israel, his people, when he refers done, and so he's used as an instrument, thereby he's called the instrument or the servant of God. Now at this point, Jeremiah openly declares the word of God to the king. One of the few books written by a Gentile, number one, or a chapter in the Bible, but it's his testimony, essentially, of how he came to know the true and the living God. And so it's pretty cool. But God will use Nebuchadnezzar and Babylon to correct and chasten his children. Basically, God has put it all in the hands of the king of Babylon, the people, the land, the beasts, the whole enchilada. And so these guys now face a tremendous choice. So all the nations shall serve him, verse 7, his son and his son's son, until the time of his land comes, and then many nations and great kings will make him serve them. So there's going to be the season where Nebuchadnezzar conquers and vanquishes, and everybody has to serve him. But then there's going to come a time when his kingdom is conquered, and they'll be servants to the other guys. And so, Lane, talking about history before it actually happens, but the nations will not, they'll serve Nebuchadnezzar, but not forever. You notice they will serve during Nebuchadnezzar's reign and that of his son and of his son's son. And so basically his dynasty, remember, his father was the first king. So there'll end up being four kings in the Babylonian Empire, but with the last king, it's all over with for them because they end up getting conquered themselves. But in 2 Kings chapter 25, verse 27, it's also recorded in Jeremiah 52, verse 31, it says, now it came to pass in the 37th year of the captivity of Jehoiakim, king of Judah, remember he was taken captive, in the 12th month of the 27th day of the month, that evil Merodach, king of Babylon, that's Nebuchadnezzar's son, in the year that he began to reign, released Jehoiakim, king of Judah, from prison. And so that's his son. He reigns for a season, and he has compassion on this young king that was taken captive. But he'd been in prison for 37 years. It's a long time. And then in Daniel chapter 5, verse 22, it describes the scene where evil Merodach's son, we know him as Belshazzar, and he was the grandson of Nebuchadnezzar. He was throwing a feast for his princes and nobles, and at one point he decides to pull out the sacred cups and vessels and things from the temple and began to toast the god of gold and silver in them. And then all of a sudden a hand appears on the wall and begins to write something that he didn't understand. And so nobody can figure it out, but the queen mother remembers, hey, there was a guy in your grandfather's kingdom that could interpret dreams and stuff like that. So they bring Daniel in, and you know how this goes. Daniel interprets it for him. Hey, you've been found wanting, and you know, basically thought you're going to die. And so that's Belshazzar. So there's the king's son, the king's grandson, Belshazzar, who was conquered by Cyrus the Great, as the Medo-Persians conquer the great city of Babylon and the kingdom itself. Now, previously, in Jeremiah 25, verse 11, it says, "And this whole land shall be a desolation and an astonishment, and these nations shall serve the king of Babylon 70 years. And so remember that the 70 years would be in fulfillment of the Sabbath for the land that they had neglected to observe while they occupied the land. And so that 70 years spans the time between Nebuchadnezzar, his son, and his son's son. And so it plays out exactly as the Bible says it will. In verse 8, "And it shall be that nation and kingdom which will not serve Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, which will not put its neck under the yoke of the king of Babylon, that nation I will punish, says the Lord, with the sword, the famine, and the pestilence, until I've consumed them by his hand." And so the kings that won't submit to God's appointed servant, in this case Nebuchadnezzar, will be severely dealt with, the sword, the famine, and the pestilence, until they're consumed from off the land. Now, there's always a heavy price to pay for rebellion against God's word. These guys aren't particularly known for being obedient to God's word to begin with. And so in a certain sense, it's an absolute long shot that any of them, including Zedekiah, would go, "Oh, okay, the Lord says do this, we'll do it." You know, that would be a miraculous thing to begin with. But God is going to give his favor to his servants, the Babylonians, and essentially they're going to be unstoppable. And this is described in previous chapters that, every arrow they shoot and every horse that runs, I mean, they're going to have strength and success and favor. Why? Not because they're such a great military power, but because God's going to be behind it. I cringe when I hear about some of the generals and the politicians in Israel. They talk about their military success and the favor they've been given from God. They go, "Yeah, we've got the best Air Force. We've got the best Army." And it's like, no. The only favor you've got is because God is totally on your side, whether you deserve it or not, you know. And so God is going to give his favor to his servants, the Babylonians, and again, they're going to be unstoppable. And he's the one that calls me to go do something. Guess what? He gives you the favor and the ability and the strength to do it. And so as long as you know you're doing God's will, you're in good shape. But here the Babylonians are going to be unstoppable. In Jeremiah 25, verse 9, "Behold, I will send and take all the families of the north, says the Lord, and Nebuchadnezzar, the king of Babylon, my servant, and will bring them against this land, against its inhabitants, against these nations all around, and will utterly destroy them and make them an astonishment, a hissing, and perpetual desolations." And so in verse 9, "Therefore, do not listen to your prophets, your divine." Listen to these false prophets, but you know, it's kind of he connects them to and likens them to diviners and sorcerers, you know, and witches and all that kind of stuff. I mean, these prophets, they call them prophets. I'm calling them false prophets, but they're likened unto the diviners and sorcerers, both of which are condemned in Scripture. going back to Deuteronomy chapter 18, verses 10, 11, and 12, it says, there shall not be found among you anyone who makes his son or daughter pass through the fire, or who practices witchcraft, or a soothsayer, or one who interprets omens, or a sorcerer, or one who conjures spells, or a medium, or a spiritist, or one who calls up the dead. For all who do these things are an abomination to the Lord. But the prophet who presumes to speak a word in my name, which I have not commanded him to speak, or speaks in the name of other gods, that prophet shall die. Funny, God takes a pretty dim view of witchcraft and sorcery and those kinds of things. And, you know, as a Christian, we should love the things that he loves and hate the things that he hates, you know. And so that's a clue for a lot of us, I think. But in Isaiah chapter 8, verse 19, and when they say to you, seek those who are mediums and wizards who whisper and mutter, should not a people seek their God? Should they seek the dead on behalf of the living? It's like, what are you doing? You know, as these guys have gone off and done these weird things. So don't listen to these guys. He says that a few times. Verse 10, for they prophesy a lie to you to remove you far from your land, and I will drive you out, and you will perish. He doesn't say you might perish. Oh, you're going to have a really bad day. You know, you will perish if you go this way. The wages of sin is death. And so if you continue on this track, you're toast, basically. They prophesy lies to you. You know what? That's what false prophets do. You know, I don't expect truth from Joel Osteen. I don't expect truth from Bill Johnson or some of these other guys that are out there that are false teachers and so on. I mean, it's like the old attorney joke. How do you know that an attorney is lying to you? His lips are moving, you know? And if the false prophet's lips are moving, it's compromised, you know? Jeremiah 23, verse 16, thus says the Lord of hosts, do not listen to the words of the prophets who prophesy to you. They make you worthless. They speak a vision of their own, not from the mouth of the Lord. And so we have to have some kind of discernment. And I believe that these false prophets are literally inspired by Satan. False prophets, it says, you're going to be killed. You're going to be wiped out. So the end of that is death. Well, who wants them to die? God doesn't want them to die. God's trying to warn them. But if they listen to these false teachers, they're going to end up dead. You know, Jesus tells us in John chapter 10, verse 10, the thief does not come except to steal and to kill and to destroy. And that's what the enemy does. But Jesus says, I have come that they may have life and that they may have it more abundantly. You know, in the Proverbs, it talks about that those that take heed to my word, they're going to be rewarded, they're going to live. There's inherent blessing in keeping God's word, but rejecting God's word and going the other direction is just the opposite. There's no expectation of blessing there. In fact, you know, it's very bad. Now, in verse 11, he says, but the nations that bring their necks under the yoke of the king of Babylon and serve him, I will let them remain in their own land, says the Lord, and they shall till it and dwell in it. I mean, that is a deal. I mean, if you'll just essentially surrender to the king of Babylon, you will live and you'll stay in your land, and, you know, life will kind of go on. It'll be different in some ways. Won't be ravished, their lands therefore choose life that both you and your descendants may live. And again, they have this choice to make. In verse 12, I also spoke to Zedekiah, king of Judah, according to all these words, saying, bring your necks under the yoke of the king of Babylon and serve him and his people. Then the last two words, and kick king of Judah. He's not actually the final king, because Jesus is the final king. But he's the last, you know, earthly king of Judah. And he's told, submit to the king of Babylon, serve him and live. And, you know, but think about this. I was trying to put myself in Zedekiah's shoes. I'm hearing from the prophet. I already know that I've rebelled against Nebuchadnezzar. I've, you know, made my plans to get these nations around me. And I think I can hold out. I think I can fight this fight. Whether I can or not, doesn't matter. That's what I think. And the prophet comes and tells me, surrender to Nebuchadnezzar. He could be thinking a couple things. That's stupid. If I surrender, he'll kill me. And I'm thinking, no, he's going to kill you anyway. But I mean, you know, but he's thinking in his mind, surrendering to him, that would be so humiliating. I mean, who knows what he'll do to him, you know, if he'll kill him or not. He just says he'll live, doesn't say he'll live luxuriously. He might live in prison. I don't know. We don't know. I'm trying to think about it from Zedekiah's standpoint. Maybe his pride gets in the way. He goes, I can't surrender. I already, you know, flipped him off. You know, whatever. I ticked him off. Why couldn't he surrender? Pride. You know, and so often, and this is true in our own lives, but so often the things that God tells us to do don't seem to make sense. I mean, from our worldly perspective, our own intellect or whatever, we think things are going to go a certain way. But if I do what God says to do, it's just going to get worse, it's going to blow up, it's going to be really bad. And God's ways so often are not our ways. You know, it's just the opposite. But God's ways work. You know, Jesus told his disciples in Matthew chapter 19, verse 30, he said, but many who are first will be last, and the last will be first. In Matthew 23, verse 11, but he who is greatest among you shall be your servant. And so it's kind of like this backwards kind of a reasoning thing that seems to dominate oftentimes. Sense. But it comes from God, so that means it makes perfect sense. One of us must be wrong, and it's not God. And when we do it God's way, it's a and so these guys are in this predicament. You know, he's already agreed to serve Nebuchadnezzar and who put him under tribute. He's rebelled against that. He's teamed up with Egypt to overthrow the Babylonians, and that failed. Perhaps it's now a matter of pride or trust. We don't know. But God is saying, if you'll submit, you'll live. That doesn't seem to make sense, but, you know, he ends up dying, so it would have been better off to try it anyway. I think Zedekiah is reasoning it through on his own, and he doesn't see it happening the way he wants it to happen. And all I can say is what Isaiah said in Isaiah 55, verses 8 and 9, where God says, for my thoughts are not your thoughts, nor are your ways my ways, says the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. You know, you think you know, but we got to, that's where we walk by faith and not by sight. All I know is that in the end of this, he ended up dead. And in Proverbs chapter 14, verse 12, it says, there's a way that seems right to a man, but its end is the way of death. And that's exactly what happened, or will happen, to Zedekiah. Then in verse 13, it kind of, you know, I don't know. God's having this conversation and trying to reason with Zedekiah. I got tired of it a long time ago. I would say, hey, dude, turn or burn, we're done. You know, figure it out. But God keeps, in his infinite grace and his mercy, keeps trying to reason with what it would appear to be an unreasonable man. And he says in verse 13, why will you die, you and your people, by the sword and by the famine and by a pestilence, as the Lord has spoken against the nations that will not serve the king of Babylon? You know, they've been warned and warned again. And he's asked the question, why will you die, you and your people? And honestly, it sounds a little bit like kind of how the gospel goes sometimes. I've asked people, really? You'd rather go to hell? You know, you would rather die? You would rather rebel against God and take what comes with that? I mean, have you thought this through? You know, and it's People do. They want to keep hang on to their sin. They don't want to repent or whatever, and they don't want to change their lifestyle. And they go, yeah, I think I'd rather go to hell than have to change my lifestyle. And it just like it baffles the mind sometimes. You know, Jesus told us in John chapter 3, verse 36, he who believes in the Son has everlasting life, and he who does not believe the Son shall not see life, but the wrath of God abides on him. And so, you know, really, why will you die, you and your people? I'll give you the answer. Foolishness, rebellion, pride, disobedience. You know, I mean, it's pretty plain. In Proverbs chapter 8, verse 36, it says, but he who sins against me wrongs his own soul, and all those who hate me love death. And sadly, we'll see that kind of played out. In verses 14 and 15, he says, therefore, do not listen to the words of the prophets who speak to you, saying, you shall not serve the kingdom of Babylon, for they prophesy a lie to you. For I have not sent them, says the Lord, yet they prophesy a lie in my name, that I may drive you out, that you may perish, you and the prophets who prophesy to you. And so there must have been guys running around, at, you know, directly contradicting the message that Jeremiah was bringing. So, no, don't worry about it. You're going to be fine. You know, and I have unfortunately been in that situation where people have come to me for counsel after they've gone to someone else, and they laid out the scenario and go, no. The Bible says if you continue to do this, the Bible says you will not inherit the kingdom of heaven, which is a real nice way of saying you're going to go to hell. And, well, so-and-so told me, or this other person said, and so I don't know about that, but I just turned my Bible around and said, would you read that out loud? And I take them to 1 Corinthians 6, 9 and 10, or Ephesians 5, or different places, and said, you know, it's not my word. It doesn't matter what they said. It doesn't matter what I say. What matters is what God's words say. And so you got to be careful to not listen to false prophets. And, you know, we've been told many, many times, our Lord Jesus tells us, you know, beware, be careful. You know, in the last days, many will come trying to deceive you. And so we've got to really have our spiritual discernment going at all times. John writes in 1 John chapter 4, verse 1, he says, beloved, do not believe every spirit, but test the spirits, whether they are of God, because many false prophets have gone out into the world. How do you test the spirits? You're holding it in your hand, folks. Compare it to God's word. And if what they say is consistent with God's word, that's good. If it contradicts God's word in any way, then what they're saying is false, and that makes them a false prophet. You know, Jesus warned us, take heed in Matthew 24. Take heed that no one deceives you. When you're ignorant, it's easier to be deceived. Now, you may be a brand new baby Christian, and if you've got the Holy Spirit living in you, you know, even as a brand new baby Christian, the Holy Spirit will give you a check in the spirit when people tell you things that are contrary to God's word. I know, because it happened to me. As a fairly new believer, ungrounded in God's word, people would say things to me, and I'm like, and I couldn't tell them why it was wrong. I couldn't put my finger on chapter and verse, but I knew something. I had these little red flags going off in my brain going, this doesn't sound right to me, you know. And I was just kind of a naturally suspicious person anyway. But then I got grounded in God's word, and more grounded, I hope and pray. And sometimes people would say, well, hang on, that's not what Hebrews says, you know, and flip over to Hebrews. Here's what it says. And so that comes right back to making sure that you study God's word. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 15. Study to show yourself approved unto God, or a workman that needs not be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. And, you know, making yourself familiar with God's word. You know, immersing yourself in God's word. You know, washing in it daily and partaking of it daily. And over time, it builds up, and pretty quick, you find that your answers are more and more biblical, and they're based on Scripture, which is how we're supposed to reason through things, you know, in this world and compare it to Scripture, because we can't believe every spirit. I love what Paul said in Acts chapter 17, verse 11, when he said, these are more fair-minded than those in Thessalonica in that They receive the word of God with all readiness of mind and search the scriptures daily to find out whether these things were so. We need to be Bereans. We need to, you know, study our Bibles and compare what we heard and go home and check out your Bible or, you know, grab it and look at it. And so they're being told, you know, they're warned against false prophets. And then again in verse 17, he says, do not listen to them. Serve the king of Babylon and live. Why should this city be laid waste? It's amazing to me to think. I mean, I think about the terror of the destruction of Jerusalem. We were in Israel a couple years ago. We're at the base of the Temple Mount. They cleared away all the rubble. Because when the Babylonians, actually the last time, when the Romans did it, they just kind of cleaned the slate, cleaned off the Temple Mount, and all of it fell down. Well, they pulled all the rocks and stuff out. And I kind of draw the comparison, I guess. But in a certain sense, that didn't have to happen. They could have just said, well, you know, we're sorry and we'll serve you and, you know, go with, be obedient to what God's word said. And the temple didn't have to be destroyed. The city didn't have to be destroyed. It was destroyed because of their choices. They go, well, you know, we're not going to do that. And so now he speaks specifically to the priest and all the people. So basically he's covering all the bases, the king, the priest, and the people. But at this point, and I think we've gone way beyond this, but I mean, at this point for sure, they're going to be without excuse. They're not going to be able to say they didn't know, they weren't warned. Hey, I didn't know. I got there late and didn't see it. No, they've all heard. They've been told. He starts with the king, starts with the priests and the prophets, and now the people. Everybody hears it. And again, they're going to be without excuse. Very much like Romans chapter 1, verses 20 and forward, it says, for since the creation of the world, his invisible attributes are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead, so that they are without excuse. Because although they knew God, they did not glorify him as God, nor were thankful, but became futile in their thoughts, and their foolish hearts were darkened. Professing to be wise, they became fools. I mean, I hate to say it this way, but I've asked a guy one time, somebody had been sharing the gospel with him. He'd heard it a dozen times before that. This guy was sharing the gospel again. This gruff old Marine Corps vet sat back and just, you know, kind of scowled, nah. And I just asked the guy that was doing the talk, and I said, can I talk to him for just a second? And he was kind of like, yeah, can't hurt. And I turned to the guy and said, Paul, said, you understand the gospel? And he goes, yeah. You understand if you reject it, you're going to go to hell? He goes, yeah. I said, don't be stupid. Why be stupid? Why go to hell? That's the dumbest thing on the planet. And he goes, hey, you're right. And he prayed to receive Jesus, you know. But that's kind of where we're at here. Don't be stupid. You know, don't do the dumb thing. It's the same message, you know. And they're being told, be careful who you listen to. Stay away from false prophets. You know, these guys are contradicting God's stated word. You know, give them, and giving them a false hope. You know, why should you be destroyed? Then moving on to verse 18, it says, but if they are prophets, and if the word of the Lord is with them, let them now make intercession to the Lord of hosts, that the vessels which are left in the house of the Lord, in the house of the king of Judah, and at Jerusalem, do not go to Babylon. And so he's saying, hey, if these guys really are legit, then let them do a couple things that a legit prophet would do. First off, let him make intercession to the Lord. Cry out to God. See, I don't think these false prophets were doing that. I think they were listening to, you know, the snake god somewhere, you know, or whatever's going on. They weren't listening to the true and living God. But he says, make intercession. Cry out to the Lord on behalf of the people. And then he says, for whatever is left from the first conquest, when Nebuchadnezzar came through, he took a lot of the cool stuff. But he left some stuff behind. And it's an interesting list when you get to it. But he says, basically, if they are prophets and if the word of the Lord is with them, then let them now make intercession. And so it sounds a little bit like what we read at our prayer meeting a couple weeks ago, 2 Chronicles chapter 7, verse 14. If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven, will forgive their sin and heal their land. And so, hey, if these guys are really prophets, then let's have a prayer meeting. And it's not written in God's word, but all I'm hearing is crickets. I don't think they responded to that. In verse 19, he says, thus says the Lord of hosts concerning the pillars, concerning the sea, concerning the carts, and concerning the remainder of the vessels that remain in this city, which Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, did not take when he carried away captive Jeconiah, the son of Jehoiakim, king of Judah, from Jerusalem to Babylon, and all the nobles of Judah and Jerusalem. Yes, thus says the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, concerning the vessels that remain in the house of the Lord and in the house of the king of Judah and of Jerusalem. And so in that first conquest, Nebuchadnezzar came through and he took captives. He took Jehoiakim back to Babylon, where he died, a very ignominious death. But he also took Daniel and his friends. He took Ezekiel and some other guys, and all the craftsmen and then artisans and stuff like that. And then he also took the nicest things. Like, as you read this list about the sea, I'm going to show you a diagram real quick. See, I got my pointer here. Here's a diagram up there of Solomon's temple, which is, the glorious temple. And you can see there's the, when it talked about the sea, work. Okay, pointing to this round thing here, it was a big brass bowl, gigantic, as big as, it's like 12 feet across or 15 feet across, something like that. And these big brass bowls, there was 12 of them, four sets of three that held it up. And that was the brazen sea that used to be in front of the tabernacle. And the purpose was for the priest to do their ceremonial cleansing. So they would take water from that. But it was big. I mean, it was higher than the priest could reach. And so they had a way of, like spigots and stuff to get it out. And then you'll see that they have these two pillars, a big brass pillar, one's called Boaz, the other one's called Jachin. And they didn't take these things. When he went in and took a bunch of other stuff, he didn't take these things. These things are still left. So he's telling if you're really a prophet, you'll intercede and ask God to put it in Nebuchadnezzar's heart to leave these things here versus taking everything. Okay. Over here, these other things are called, they're brazen or brass carts with a big basin in it, and they would roll them around with water in it for cleaning the animals and, the priest to wash in, all that kind of stuff. So he says in verse 19 concerning the pillars, and that's the Boaz and Jachin, the sea, which is the big laver to wash in, the carts, and the remainder of the vessels. Now, some things are not mentioned here that you would think would be prominent, because I believe they're already in Babylon. If you look at that chart up there, you can see that there's the tables of showbread. Each of those tables of showbread had the 12 loaves for each of the tribes. They were made of solid gold. And you don't hear about them because they're gone. The menorah, behind each table of showbread, there's a menorah. And this is a big expanded version of the tabernacle, because Solomon went way overboard and making it bigger and better, so to speak. But the simple tabernacle back in the day had one table of showbread, one menorah in the holy place, and one altar of incense. This one still has just one altar of incense, which is made of solid gold as well. Those things aren't mentioned because I believe they've already been taken to Babylon in that first. They came through and said, oh, there's some gold, and grabbed all that stuff. Brass, we got plenty of that already. They left all the brass stuff. Now, the Ark of the Covenant, when that disappeared from the temple, we don't really know. There's lots of speculation and possibilities, but it's not mentioned. I think if it had been taken, it would have been, described in some respects. I don't think the Babylonians got it. But so they got the two gigantic brass pillars. All these things are still there. And the prophet, or God through the prophet, is trying to reason with them. Hey, these things, pray and ask God that, the city's not destroyed. But we do know that when Nebuchadnezzar does come in, very shortly after this actually, and you know they reconquer the city after the siege, and they take everything of any value. So these pillars are knocked down, broken up, hauled away in pieces. The big brass laver that's, you know, really big is broken up into pieces because the brass is valuable. They take it all back. And the carts and the tools and all the stuff. And then eventually the temple and the city itself are burned to the ground. So basically there's nothing left. The walls are broken up, the whole thing. But again, this is something that didn't actually have to happen. Had they just been obedient to what God called them to do. Then finally now in verse 22, it says, they should be carried to Babylon. So God already knows what they're going to do. And there they shall be until the day that I visit them, says the Lord. Then I will bring them up and restore them to this place. Now, I like this because even in the midst of judgment, God gives them a glimmer of hope. God gives them the, you know, hey, when this season is over, and it's almost like what you read in Proverbs, this too shall pass. You know, when this season is past and I visit you again, what greater blessing than to have the true and the living God, quote unquote, visit you. Yeah, and that's what he's saying. Even though you're going to be captive and taken away, I'm going to visit you and I'm going to restore these things. Now, I think he's talking in context of all the temple instruments and all the stuff is going to be restored, brought back to when they rebuild the temple under Zerubbabel, Ezra, and Nehemiah. But I also believe it's talking about the people, that the remnant that he preserves, hides, if you will, in Babylon, because the rest are going to be killed, he'll bring a remnant back and they'll start over again, so to speak. And so I will bring them up and restore them to this place. And I like that. In Ezra, chapter 7, verse 19, it says, also the articles that are given to you for the service of the house of your God, deliver in full before the God of Jerusalem. And so Cyrus commands that as part of the list of supplies going back to Jerusalem with the captives that have been set free, they're told also take with you the articles given to you for the service of the house of God. And so it's kind of cool that Cyrus seeks to honor the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob and send those things back. Certainly a contrast from Belshazzar, who used them to profane them, you know, by making the toast and all that stuff. Anyway, that's the gist of chapter 27, and we'll pick it up in 28 next week. Father God, thank you for your word. Thank you for your love and your goodness and your faithfulness. And Lord, as we examine the options here, Lord, we choose you. We pray the path of obedience. We ask, Lord, that you would help us to do that which you call us to do and to be yielded to everything that you want done. And so, Lord, help us to learn this lesson and to walk in your ways. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Hey, if you guys are able, let's stand together and worship.
O Lord, attend unto my prayer. From the ends of the earth will I cry out to thee. And when my heart is overwhelmed, lead me to the rock that is higher than I. For thou hast been a shelter unto me, a high tower, Lord, against the enemy. And when my heart is overwhelmed, lead me to the rock that is higher than I, that is higher than I. Hear my cry, O Lord, attend unto my prayer. the ends of the earth will I cry out to thee. And when my heart is overwhelmed, lead me to the rock that is higher than I, that is higher than I. For thou hast been a shelter unto me, a high tower, Lord, against the enemy. And when my heart is overwhelmed, lead me to the rock that is higher than I, that is higher than I. Upon thee and give thee peace.
Well, tell them that the guys up under the girl on this because it's still kind of real good. God bless you guys. Have a great night. You need prayer for any reason, come on up. We would love to pray with you. Happy Thanksgiving.